On this week's show, the Tesla Model 3 finally gets unveiled, Volkswagen recalls the Ego for a potential stall risk, and Toyota unveils the Prius Prime. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories you're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, April 1st, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and I'd just like to give a special shout out to everyone who saw us at the Washington Square Mall in Portland, Oregon yesterday. It was so great to see so many of you and hear all those different stories about why you were queuing to buy a Tesla Model 3. Of course, the Tesla Model 3 launched yesterday. It was officially unveiled last night at a special gala event in Hawthorne, California. But before we get to the car itself, it's worth mentioning the insane queues that formed at Tesla stores around the world ahead of the big reveal, just so that Tesla faithful could put down their deposits, sight unseen, on a car that they hoped would change the world. Here in Portland, Oregon, there were a good 300 or more people queuing up before the Tesla store opened, and at last night's reveal event, Tesla CEO Elon Musk said that more than 115,000 people around the world had put down their $1,000 or equivalent deposits before the car had even been shown to the general public. By the end of the day, that figure had risen to 180,000 people. That's insane! Which brings us to the car itself. Looking like a cross between a Tesla Model S and a Tesla Model X, perhaps some Jaguar or Aston Martin thrown in for fun, the Tesla Model 3 is a five-seat mid-size sedan with a 0-60 time of under 6 seconds, autopilot and supercharger hardware included from the factory, and a clever interior design which moves the front seats forward and the rear seats backward to maximize space while retaining the front frunk and rear trunk. Tesla CEO Elon Musk was pretty thin on specs last night. There is a predicted EPA range of at least 215 miles per charge for the entry-level model and predicted 5-star crash ratings all round, but frustratingly, no details on any of the options or pricing we're going to see. Rumours suggest a higher-end Model 3 will be available at some point for far more money, and we also note that Tesla did not confirm if autopilot and supercharger features would cost extra on the $35,000 car, or if indeed supercharging will be free. It's just that the equipment will be included. Worthy of note, that full-length glass roof, which morphs into the rear window and gives the Model 3 so much space. But while it's certainly aesthetically pleasing, I'm not a fan of some of the other bits of the car, it also means that the Tesla Model 3 lacks the hatchback, which makes the Model S so practical. And if, like me, you've got dogs, kids, or hobbies that require a nice big hatchback, you're not going to want to put that deposit down. We're sure the polarizing design of the Model 3 will mellow a bit before the car actually launches in 2017, or more likely 2018, but we're curious to know what you think of this important car right now. Let us know in the comments below. With the Model 3 reveal out of the way, it's now time to look at some of the other stories that have made the headlines this week. And so with that, we've got some news of a recall involving certain model year Volkswagen e-Golf electric cars. As we explained midweek, the e-Golf was quietly recalled earlier this month by Volkswagen after a series of complaints were received by the US National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, or NHTSA for short, concerning sudden failures which left drivers stranded at the side, and sometimes in the middle, of the road. At the heart of the problem is an oversensitive battery management system, which can misinterpret heavy acceleration or regenerative braking as a potentially dangerous current spike, thus turning off the car's main power circuits to protect the battery. Volkswagen says owners of affected cars will be contacted in due course, with all remedial work carried out under warranty at their local e-Golf approved dealership. So if you've got a 2014 through 2015 e-Golf, keep your eyes on the mail for that all-important recall notice. A car that doesn't need an official NHTSA recall right now is a Mitsubishi Outlander PHEV, but that's not because it hasn't gone wrong, it's because it hasn't yet launched in the US. And this week, we told you that US launch for the long-awaited plug-in hybrid SUV has just been pushed back again to late 2016. The car, which has been on sale in Europe and Asia since 2013, combines a 16 kilowatt-hour lithium-ion battery pack and 2.0-litre gasoline engine for a real-world range of around 20 miles per charge. But while that's not much, its form factor, a mid-size SUV, has made it more popular in the UK in recent months than the Nissan Leaf electric hatchback. Of the delayed Mitsubishi Outlander plug-in hybrid launch in the US, representatives of Mitsubishi say the Japanese automaker is still finalising specification. But we can't help wonder if Mitsubishi is feeling threatened by all those other plug-in cars coming to market, which could probably outperform and outprice it. I guess time will tell. From one plug-in hybrid now to another, in the form of the all-new 2017 Toyota Prius Prime, which launched last week at the New York Auto Show. But due to there being no show last week, we had a family medical emergency, sorry, we've decided to throw it in this week so you can hear a little more about the new addition to the Prius family. Based on the new 2016 Prius liftback, the Prius Prime, the first plug-in hybrid Prius to get its own name badge, features unique styling front and rear to differentiate it from the non-plug-in Prius, and manages to pack an 8.8 kilowatt-hour lithium-ion battery pack under the floor for a total of 22 miles of range per charge in true all-electric mode, no power blending. Interestingly, however, Toyota has opted to make the Prius Prime a four-seater rather than a five-seater, a move which could make it less popular with customers used to picking a Prius for its practicality and overall fuel economy. Pricing will come in the coming months, but as with the Model 3, we'd like to hear your thoughts on Toyota's latest plug-in in the comments below. While it didn't make an official debut in New York, Hyundai's all-new 2017 IONIQ, a brand new model offered in electric, plug-in hybrid and hybrid guises, did make its US debut there last week, which gave Hyundai a chance to give some official predictions concerning fuel economy and range of its trifecta of eco-minded cars. As part of that, Hyundai US officials confirmed that the South Korean automaker is shooting for an EPA-approved range of 110 miles per charge for the all-electric IONIQ, a range which we'll admit leaves us a little disappointed. Why? Well, unlike the recently upgraded range of the Nissan Leaf and upcoming range improvements for the e-Golf and BMW i3, the IONIQ is a brand new car that will likely be on the market for the next 5 years or more. And that means that while this 110-mile EPA range could put it at the top of the affordable car range chart for a few months, it will soon be overshadowed by the Chevrolet Bolt EV and plenty more next-generation cars due in the coming months and years. And that makes us just a little bit sad because, after all, who wants a limited-range car when there are better choices just around the corner? Staying with Hyundai and its zero-emission cars now, we're heading over to the UK, where British magazine Autocar was told this week by a UK Hyundai executive that the company officials have already signed off on the design of its next-generation hydrogen fuel cell car, and that that design is for another SUV. Of course, this isn't the next-generation SUV in question. This is the Hyundai Tucson FCV, or Hyundai iX35 FCV, depending on where you happen to live in the world. But it seems that unlike Honda and Toyota, who are focusing on the hydrogen fuel cell sedan market, Hyundai has decided to continue working with midsize SUVs instead. From an engineering point of view, it does make sense, especially given the extra ground clearance that comes from an SUV that can help with the space needed for storing those bulky hydrogen fuel cell tanks low in the chassis. But with no word on price or market launch, we really can't comment until we have more information. It's small, it seats two, and is probably the closest thing you can buy in Europe that resembles a road-legal go-kart. And now the tiny Renault Twizy has been officially approved for use on the roads of Quebec. As we detailed last year, French electric vehicle charging network AZA has been working hard to get the tiny two-seat approved for use in Canada to allow it to be used in the busy urban centres like Montreal. After some minor modifications, one to drop the speed to 40 kilometers per hour and others to add extra reflectors and lights required by local statutes, the Twizy is now officially approved for Canadian markets and will officially launch there later this month at a special event in the French Canadian capital. We'll have more news about final pricing and specifications nearer to that event, but if you're looking for a fun runabout in North America, although it might not be yet approved for all US states, you might be one step closer now than you were a few months ago. From a car that reminds me of a go-kart to a much larger, faster track-going EV in the form of the Formula E race series now, which is gearing up for its sixth round race weekend in Long Beach, California. And as we told you earlier this week, enigmatic electric car startup Faraday Future, which has still to show anyone the car it plans to bring to market, or even officially show a test mule, was announced recently as official Formula E race sponsor for Saturday's race. As a consequence, FF will get to display the same concept FF01 electric race car it unveiled at CES back in January, and says it will also be handing out goodies to fans who turn up at the event. While FF's sponsorship of Formula E is certainly more than most electric car companies or automakers have done to support electric motorsport thus far, we can't help but bemoan the fact that without a car, it's kind of hard to get excited about this involvement, because right now, FF is just a name without a product. But if you're going this weekend, at least you'll be able to see some of the strange concept car in the carbon fiber reinforced plastic, so to speak. And finally, we started today's show with Tesla, and we're back to Tesla to finish, but this time not with one of its cars. And that's because over the Easter weekend, our good friends at Above Reno headed over to the Tesla Gigafactory construction site to film a follow-up video to the beautiful 4K video taken about 9 months ago. The new video, which of course is also in 4K glory, shows just how much progress has been made at the Gigafactory site and shows one side of the factory completed and in operation, while the other side is still being assembled piece by piece. What you're seeing here is just about one quarter of the total finished area, but even now it's super impressive. Cell production for the Model S, Model X, Model 3 and Tesla Energy products will start in the near future, and we're excited to see just how quickly the last bit of the first quarter will be finished to ensure cell production can continue at maximum speed. I am certainly not at maximum speed today. After this is all edited and uploaded, I'm off to do very little for the rest of the weekend. I think with all the Model 3 coverage, I put in about 50 hours this week and I need a well-earned rest. Hopefully well-rested. I'll be back next week at the usual time for another show. But in the meantime, you can find all the news that's fit to print at our website at transportevolved.com. Catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolve or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please keep us independent and impartial by visiting our Patreon page at patreon.com/transportevolved and pledging your support from as little as $1 per month. Putting on all-day event coverage like we did yesterday is an expensive and time-consuming business, and with our skeleton staff, it means we can only do so much before collapsing in a heap on the floor. The more support we get from you, the more people we can have covering the event, and the less likely it is that you'll see transportive old folks incoherent and babbling about supercharger networks. So go on, help us out. As always, there's a lot we haven't managed to fit into today's show, including details of a new world record attempt being made tomorrow at the Long Beach Formula E E-Prix, Faraday Future lets EV enthusiasts into its top secret facility, the G-Wiz gets its spiritual successor in the UK, and we ask if Chinese automakers can reach market dominance by learning the EV trade through plagiarizing other vehicles, essentially cloning. So when we're done, be sure to head to our website to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.